standing by.
One. You are alive, you are alive.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming.
Hello, everybody, and a happy 4th of July to everybody in the United States of America. This is the only kind of American accent I can do, so I'm going to be doing it the whole drive. I hope you enjoy it. My name's James. On camera, we got Brian with his American thumb. That's a great American thumb you got there, Brian. Well done. It's very nice. Over there, we got some hippopotamus, we got some buffaloes, and we got some elephants, and some waterbuck as well. That's enough of that. Right, welcome to it, everybody. We're on to the sunset safari on this, the 4th of July, 2016. And, of course, in America, celebrating the independence from Great Britain circa 1776. That is a very, very long time ago. Anyway, I hope you're having a wonderful family holiday there in the United States, and in honor of your holiday, we are going to be doing a small competition between Jamie and I. It's called a mammal race. Now, we have got the long lens, so I'm hoping we're going to be able to win it. We're also going to do a bird race. So, mammals already. So that's pretty good going. Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Jamie Patterson is going to be presenting from the other vehicle. She's being filmed by the lovely, luscious brunette locks of David Eastor, and in the final control, the terrifying figure of Kirsten McLennan-Smith, ably assisted by the guns of Louise Pavide. Welcome to the 4th of July special. Here we go. Our plan this afternoon is going to be to head to Cheetah Plains, but I think we're actually going to sit here for a little while because there's quite an array of animals going on here. Now, this particular waterhole is going to become a serious focal point over the next little while. As we've discussed, there is a serious amount of dry... that's a terrible way of putting it. We've had a very dry rainy season. We're into the middle of now our dry season, which is going to be very unusual. In fact, I'm going to sneak forward so that we can get a better view of that hippo. He's just going into the water there. This is not an ideal hippo territory by any stretch, and he was in that water until those elephants chased him out of it. They were deeply unimpressed to find someone else in the water. The buffalo bulls are going to spend a lot of time around here, because this is where they like to be. They must have water if they're going to cope with the very poor quality of the forage. And as long as there is poor quality, or as long as there is some water, they can cope with just about the worst kinds of forage there is. Beautiful afternoon, very silent afternoon. And that's because, well, it's the middle of the afternoon and everything's in the midday lull. Right, Brian, we've got first bird over there, Birchall starling, on the ground. Let's hit that one. There we go. And now, Brian, I'm going to ask you to do a zip pan. Whip pan, sorry, to a red-billed hornbill. Kirsten, you have to keep tally, right? I don't have to count these, correct? Eating termites. Red-billed hornbill eating termites out of, I don't know, perhaps odontotermes. Then we've got red-billed oxpecker on top of the buffalo bull over there. I really am asking you to do a lot of whipping around, Brian. There it is. It's on that beefalo there. And we luckily have the long lens. This is, of course, cheating. And we will, just to remind you, we do have a fireside chat for 15 minutes at the end of this drive, 4th of July special and all that. And then, Brian, to the left of that, we've got a Natal Franklin on the ground, if I'm not mistaken. Keep going. Underneath, fossicking about in those branches, those dead, that pile of dead sticks. Keep going left. You got him. Buddy. We're doing okay. I don't suppose bird calls count, do they? I could give you Oriole, but I don't think we can count them. Kirsten says, absolutely not. Don't be ridiculous, you imbecile. Sorry, Kirsten. All right, let's go across to Jamie for the next 3.5 seconds so that she can find something also for you to look at. But come back quickly because I don't want to lose this competition.
Well, now that James has established himself, I have seen absolutely nothing on my way to Arethusa. But hello, my name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have Dave on camera with me. Dave, there's a bird. There's a bird, Dave. Dave, it's a chagra. They never sit still, Dave. Oh, no. Where's it gone, Dave? There it is. It is hopping about in the base of all of those dead leaves. Oh, and I can hear a go-away bird calling. You've got it. Well done. There is a go-away bird, everybody. Tick that one off our list. Fantastic. We're off to a dramatic start with our go-away birds. I don't want to lose this competition. James is on 9. I am on 2. I'm not even sure that the chagra really counts, but we're on 2. Are we going to take it? I don't even think we should take that one, Dave. Kirsty's accepted it, and Kirsty, of course, is the adjudicator of all things, since she is the director, so we've accepted that one. We're now on 2, James is on 9, let us not delay, let us carry on driving. And we are off on our live safari. Ooh. Now, you see, Wendy's clutch isn't right. Anyway. No, now it's stuck. It's stuck in. That's right. We just need, it's hydraulic, we just need to get the pressure up. There we go. Ah, voila. Okay, onwards, but not too far in case we have to be towed home. I do know what the problem with Wendy's clutch is, by the way, and Steph is on his way to rescue us with a spare part. And since we're driving along and having this very special competition, just to wish all of our viewers a very happy 4th of July, and of course, since Wild Earth is a global community, that independence from the year 1946, I'll leave you to do the rest of the history reading yourselves. And then, of course, our multiple viewers in Rwanda, who celebrate Liberation Day on the 4th of July in order to celebrate their liberation around the time of 1994. So a very special day for lots of members of the various Wild Earth community and viewers. Right, Drongo! Drongo, there's a Drongo! Fantastic. Tick number 3. Dave, there's more there. There's more there, Dave. Oh no! No, Dave! Those were some female weavers that just fluttered off into the distance. Do we count them? Maybe not. We'll settle for 3. Ah, Kirsty's counting them as well. I think Kirsty might be on my side. And of course we have the added advantage of the lovely Chelsea Green on the back of the vehicle as well. So Chelsea, earn your keep. Very soft little voice. Oh no. James's lead is building. James has found something else. Let's go and find out what it is.
Does it move? Everybody, there was a black-collared barbet there, of course, but I've been sabotaged by girl power. The link didn't come fast enough. You see, they knew I had a bird, and so they didn't link to me, because they knew. Black-collared barbet. It goes, tupadli, 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 tupadli. But it ain't going too puddly nothing now, is it?
No.
No. Disaster. They're American.
I don't think they look that bad.
Don't you?
No.
Yes, okay.
Marvellous.
No, I don't think I'll wear them. We're going to roll gently down this hill. There. There it is. It's in that tree there. I've spotted it, Brian. Can you see it? No, that's a bush. Go to the left. Did you see it there?
No.
I can't see it anymore. It's in that bush, I promise you, everybody. It doesn't count if we don't see it. There it goes, it's flown away! Did you see it fly? You see where it landed? Shall I stop? Nothing else. So we're on nine creatures, are we? Nine creatures, Brian. Avian and mammalian. That would have been number 10 if girl power hadn't gotten our way, sabotaged us. Sisters doing it for themselves, etc., etc. Marisha in Texas, you want to know what the reward is for the team that wins. Marisha, the reward is the satisfaction of knowing the evening around the fire. Brian, would you like an extra tot of apple juice this evening?
Oh, yes, please.
Yes, please. You see.
And bragging rights.
And bragging rights, of course. What have you spotted? I thought Brian had spotted something, everybody. At the thought of that extra tot of apple juice. Yes, I know what you mean. It makes me want to drive very quickly. Of course, one mustn't drive very quickly if one wants to spot anything. Ah, Crested Franklin, on the road, number 10. Here we are. Right, let's move on. Slender mongoose. I saw it, doesn't count. See if you can see that. No, we're not linking to anybody, Kirsten. We're staying right with us. There's a slender mongoose in here. Kirsten's going to struggle to get a link. She's going to have to crash cut away from me. You may just suddenly arrive with Jamie, everyone. Kirsten, I promised there was a slender mongoose in here. No, it's gone. All right, let's go across to Jamie and get an update from her.
And hark! The diversion tactics of one who knows that he is doomed to lose this competition, because everyone knows the underdog always wins, right? Perhaps the bragging rights are what we are all looking forward to having over each other. Strangely enough, you wouldn't believe this, but there's mongoose! Oh no, don't go away. Okay, sorry, mongoose. Here we go. Now, does that count as four? Or are we really pushing things a little bit now? Even Kirsty's not quite willing to bend the rules quite to that extent on my behalf. So one of my favourite little animals to spot, and I don't want to race off because despite the competition, this is still about learning about the different wonderful animals of the African bush. But just in case it does fly away and I don't really want to lose the competition, Dave, in the far... Oh, no, almost. Now it's in the right. There we go. Now it's in the centre of the screen, sort of towards the top. It's quite all right. It is very far away. That is an emerald-spotted wood dove before it disappears. A bird considered to be of enormous bad luck in the local culture. You're not meant to listen to its entire call or else your house might burn down, which is, of course, not at all true. They're lovely birds and there's absolutely nothing that is bad luck about them. So back to our dwarf mongoose, who haven't been quite so quick at disappearing. Having a jolly good groom. And I think probably enjoy was going to lose an extremity, but fortunately we've all returned home intact and the temperature has warmed up beautifully. And I almost wish there were more hours in the day, because I would love to just spend an entire morning or an afternoon with these little chaps and just watch them, just one colony, and get an idea as to what exactly their day-to-day life entails. This, by the way, I think might be the same colony of dwarf mongoose, where if you cast your mind back many months ago, we saw the dwarf mongoose with a very white face. I've never seen him again. It was totally unique. It was with Tebs on camera with me, and it was on Halloween, and he looked like he was wearing little Halloween face paint, whether or not he is around. He or she is around. I can hear a woodpecker. Should we go search for the woodpecker? Oh, so many things to see, so little time. Torn between wanting to win this competition and watching the dwarf mongoose. To the airstrip with us. Well, that is where we often find animals. There's a drongo, we've already done that one. turtle dove, which I generally make a habit of driving past, to be completely honest, since there are many, many of them to be seen. And they're just, not just your standard dove, but they are the standard dove of this area. But since this is a competition, we shall stop and find you as many things as possible. We are up to 7, Dave. We're catching up on James. Right, so to cheating in China, you were wondering about... I've got to get out of that habit, sorry. You wanted to know whether any of our animals are fitted with GPS trackers. Yes, one in particular, a very famous little leopard called Sindile. He's not so little anymore. And that was because it was very, very unusual circumstances. He caught a domestic dog or a stray dog that had wandered off. He was put in quarantine and then released back into the area 8 months later. And due to his age and the fact that this is one of the most unique situations, he's been fitted with a GPS tracker so as to monitor his movements and his success in returning to the wild. The batteries have, I think, since run flat. And we no longer get any updates from Sindile's collar, but it was a marvelous way of learning a bit more about the way in which a leopard adjusts, having been in captivity for 8 months and then released. Other than that, there's the odd collar, so a frequency transmitter or a GPS transmitter, on some elephants and some buffalo, almost invariably due to research purposes, or for research purposes, because the act of fitting an animal with a GPS track, I want to resist linking, but I can't do that because that would be bad sportsmanship. James has something else.
Yellow-billed hornbill. There we go. There you see, yellow on its bill, ergo, yellow-billed hornbill. Number 11. I think it's eating little Combretum pulgivorous, these birds, but I suppose they have to be at this time of the year. Otherwise, it's rather quiet out here. Okay, I'm going to pop my head over the edge of Twin Dams here. Damn it. Jamie's got something else now.
Ha ha! I do indeed have something else. Bravo to Dave, who has put us back into the running once again with a lovely family of warthog, one that some of you may be familiar with. They spend a lot of time around the Arethusa airstrip, which is where, of course, where we are headed to. Two sows and their... But the four remaining piglets are almost out of the woods in terms of the age that they've reached, or at least the most dangerous time of a young warthog's life. So they often form these little sounders. The females can be related to each other, but are not necessarily. Oh, minor panic. It's okay. Crisis averted. All is well in the world. And they, I have to say, are probably one of my favourite animals to stop and look at. And whenever I see them, I automatically think of Tara Dales, the lovely lady who used to direct our shows at one point. She has since left Wild Earth, but she... This is for you, Tara, wherever you may be. Oh dear, James has found another one.
Jeepers, it took them about half an hour to get to us. The squirrels nearly died of old age. There's a squirrel, everybody. Tree squirrel. Hooray, number 12. I think they're rather splendid little creatures, especially when they knock me up a little peg or two. There we go. Tree squirrel it is. Jamie will no doubt find a leopard now, or something equally impressive, but a leopard's only 1 point. Let's see what else we can find on our way to Cheetah Plains. Maybe a cheetah. That's still only 1 point though. And thank you, safari lover Elaine. You say a big shout out to all the kids in Virginia Beach, Virginia, who watch this show and have watched it and enjoyed sort of some of their class time with us. I agree. Big shout out to all of them. And as Jamie says, to the Rwandans, and they've been through a hell of a time over in the last 20 or so years. So big shout out to them. And I didn't realize it was Philippines Independence Day as well. I don't know the Filipino national anthem. Do you, Brian?
don't.
Are you able to sing it? No.
Yeah, no.
No. I've forgotten it as well. Now, the trick is to find something before Jamie does again. Because I know that once they're on her, you see, Brian, what happens is girl power takes over. And our animals that we find die of old age before they link to us. It is so true. Hello, Gracie, aged 8 in Ohio. You say, whoever finds a cinnamon bun bird gets 1,000,000 points. Well, I agree with that. I haven't seen a cinnamon bun bird for some time, Gracie, but we'll do our best. You say we're going to have fireworks and apple juice? No, we might have apple juice. We're not going to have fireworks, Gracie. We don't have fireworks out here because it makes the animals a little bit scared. So we're not going to make any fireworks out here. But we'll light a fire in honor. Are you having fireworks, Gracie? I hope everybody is having fireworks tonight. Well, quietish fireworks. We know they do make animals a little bit terrified. Brian, this is the only drive I've been on when I've never seen...
Look, I found another one. I found another species for our list. In this case, two chaps who I don't think realize they are actually on international internet television. But there you have it. They are included in our... They are included, right, Kirst? It's a species. Nobody specified. Definitely included. Also found a cat. Haha, that joke's definitely been made before. But we found a cat. It is currently occupied in sorting things out. Right. We'll move on. We'll find you something a little bit more exciting than human activity. I'm uncertain as to what they are doing on the Arethusa airstrip. Now barred from elephant, waterbuck, and all the other multitude of things that James managed to add to his list. Oh no, it does mean that. Kirsty, what are you doing to me? So James got the hornbills as well. Oh no. I just won't stand for this. We'll have to find a leopard. We can get a grey hornbill. Great. Let's give him a quick wave. Oh dear, what that means is that my clever plan, my cunning plan of coming to the Arethusa airstrip and ticking off all of the species that might be around here, has been somewhat sabotaged. Oh, woe is me. Might just have to do a very rapid circumnavigation of the Arethusa airstrip, which is completely devoid of all life. Uh-oh. Okay, we seem to be okay. We went through a bit of a signal dip there. Roger, in Tampa, you were wondering, as we race along searching for... I hear lapwings. I see a lapwing. James hasn't got one of those yet. A crowned... No, that's a starling. Sorry. James has got one of those. They're sitting on the mounds of earth. Over there-ish. There-ish. There we go. I'm sure I saw movement there. Oh, no. There we go. There we go. Fantastic. Right. So we've crossed the crowned lapwing off our list and apparently off James's list as well. Now, as you can see, just while we have a look at how much grass there is, you can see that things are incredibly dry. Even here on the open area of the Arethusa airstrip. Roger, in Tampa, no, I have never experienced a drought of this magnitude. Apparently, the last one that is, in theory, this might actually be the worst drought in about 100 years. So no, I have never experienced a drought as severe as this one, which is both tragic but also educational, because I think we're going to be getting an idea of how incredibly well an ecosystem like this will be able to recover from a situation such as the one we're experiencing. And that, of course, is the joy of Safari Live, because it's not about coming to visit for a limited period, maybe 3 days, 4 days, a week, 2 weeks. You've got the opportunity to watch for months at a time. progress of drought. Now, before I get too distracted by this competition, pilot two. All right, over to James.
Impala, everybody, and Roller, flying. It's gone, we missed it. Right, we've got Impala, we're on to 13. I promise you, there's a real girl power problem going on here, everybody. I said, when Jamie got human being, I mean, ridiculous. She got human being, Kirsten came to me, she's got 10 now, she's nearly caught up to you. It's very unfair. Don't you think, Brian?
I do think so.
I feel we're fighting against the odds here.
We are.
We don't care that, do we, Brian? 14. There it is. Lilac-breasted Roller. And no amount of girl power is going to take away Lilac-breasted Roller from us, Brian. Oh, no. Oh, no. Let's move on. Now, they're called Rollers. Well, because they roll, they've got this amazing display that they do, normally in the summertime. But I was walking with Herbert yesterday, as I told some of you this morning, and we were going through a couple of Shangaan bird names, and that one I did know is Veve, and it's because of the call that it makes, and it's like most of these Shangaan words, onomatopoeic, it goes Veve, 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 Veve. Such a beautiful bird, such an unattractive call. Hello, Tim in Kansas City. You want to know what our main holidays here are? Well, I suppose the main holiday is the 24th of April. That is our sort of Independence Day, if you like. It's a bit like yours. And I think we call it Freedom Day, and it was the day of the first democratic elections here in 1994. So that's a very important one. Then the 16th of June is called Youth Day, and that's a very important day in our calendar because it commemorates the 1976 Soweto uprisings, where a whole group of students were basically massacred by the apartheid police for protesting against what was a pathetic education system that they were offered, 4th of September. The 24th of September is Heritage Day, and Heritage Day is when we all celebrate our heritage. So if you happen to be of Scottish origin, which I am, then you might celebrate that. Otherwise, if you're a Zulu, you might dress in your Zulu garb, or if you're a Xhosa, you might do the same. And likewise, if you're an Afrikaner, you might build yourself an ox wagon or something like that. And then I think the next important one, I don't know what they call it anymore, actually, is the 16th of December is a major public holiday. And Family Day, I think, is the 26th of December. I don't know, but those are the major holidays that we have here. And there are a number of others, but those are the major ones. Might be Workers' Day, I'm not sure. No, that's in May. Christmas Day is still a major holiday. I mean, you guys have got Thanksgiving. I'll come back to that. Jamie's got a bird.
Look, we found the other species of hornbill, barring, of course, the ground hornbill. It's a grey hornbill, really, really far away and really well hidden behind the leaves. Here you go. You can see at that point that it is, in fact, a grey hornbill. All right, so that concludes our sort of listing of the smaller hornbill species. Elephant. Oh, it doesn't count. And James Richard, you're saying now we just need to tick off the southern ground hornbill. We do. I nearly saw one this morning at Cheetah Plains, and unfortunately, I couldn't find it. I could hear it calling, that deep kook-kook-kook-kook sound that they make. Now, southern ground hornbill, of course, is very exciting, not just because it would put me in the lead, but also because they are one of our most endangered bird species. Speaking of bird species that are not endangered, Brent has found one. have any signal, leaving us free to approach this lovely elephant herd. And even if it doesn't count towards my total, we're still going to go and have a look at it because I love elephants. And as far as I'm concerned, seeing one will make any day absolutely complete. So we're going to go have a look at them anyway. Making sure I've nearly come around this corner and had a car accident before, which is very unusual out here. But of course we get out of the habit of looking both ways before we go onto a road, which we probably should do. And this is one of the main roads on Arethusa. I'm just making sure that there's no other vehicle coming. Hello, Elise. Safari times. Looks as though these guys have been having a marvelous time in the dam. Hello, girls and boy. All right, over to James while we make an approach.
Batelier, 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 everybody. Beautifully caught by Brian Joubert in full glorious flight. Look at it go. Oh, that's incredible. Isn't that wonderful? Look at it go. I can't even see it with my naked eye. Just hanging there in the air and so low down. The only bird out here that can fly that low. And that completely gracefully. You see how it's adjusting all the time. Slight adjustment, slight adjustment, slight adjustment. No tail. Very unstable. That is just the most fantastic picture. Doesn't seem to be getting any further away or closer, actually. Must be just sort of circling in one spot. Beautiful, Brian.
Oh, thank you, James.
Yes. Super. On we go. Elephants, just remind her that unfortunately we had those first. Ha ha ha.
I saw that elephant that James put on screen, but I didn't have the long lens to stop for it. I was out first. Okay, that's fine. If James wants to be a sore winner, that's okay. He's forgotten that he has to go and set up fireside chat and I don't. So, you know. I'll have an extra few moments to help me win this competition. Lovely collection of big bulls, actually. At first, when I approached, I thought girls, and I just saw combretum trees next to each other. I mean, really, they totally have. There's hardly anything left of these poor trees that found themselves the center of attention of five large elephant bulls. There's something incredibly peaceful about a sighting like this. And it just goes to show that I will always put the needs of our viewers first, even if it means that it's a species that doesn't count in the competition. Munching and while we watch our Ellie bulls size each other up and munch away at the bush willow. Miss Jin in Texas would like to send a big 4th of July shout out to all of her friends watching on YouTube. So I hope you're having a new stream. Sorry, not YouTube, you stream. I can't seem to get my words straight this afternoon. So a big shout out to all of Miss Jin's friends watching on Ustream. I hope you are having a marvelous day. And that these elephant bulls make it even more so. All roughly around larger ones might be closer to 25, even up to 30. beautiful gentleman. Oh, trunk full of sand. And I wish I could have been at Arethusa Dam when all of these gentlemen were having a mud bath, because it looks as though some of them went right in to the dam itself. There's one elephant bull that I always look for whenever I come across groups like this. I haven't seen him in a really long time, but I think he has been seen on a couple of the live safaris. There's an elephant bull with a really ragged ear and a completely dislocated or broken right hip. He's a particular elephant bull, and I haven't seen him in a long time. And the reason he comes to mind now is this is where I first saw him many months ago. It's amazing how used to or how familiar you become with the different animals in the area the longer you spend looking at them. And I think because we look through the eyes of the camera, we actually are more aware of the nuances of each individual animal. I think, boy, that bush willow is pretty much done for. It has been well and truly stripped. This is what we were talking about this morning on the Sunrise Safari. The fact that with this drought, we might actually see a change to the habitat completely. It will have an effect on it that will last for many, many years. And that's particularly because the elephants are targeting trees more and more frequently and clearing large areas of land. And if you combine that with the fact that the Kruger National Park has closed a whole load of its water holes on the western boundary, so the boundary with the Sabi Sands, we're going to be seeing more elephants as well coming in search of water. So this drought could actually shape this environment for years to come. He is having a wonderful time there, stripping away bits of bark. James has found another feathered friend.
Quickly. Very lucky. And I must just confess, it is a slight advantage we have over Jamie and David in that we have the super zoom camera. That bird is roughly the same distance away as Pluto is, and yet we've managed to get a relatively good picture of it. So that is the white crowned shrike. They're sitting on a marula tree, and we are here on Cheetah Plains now, and we're heading for the clearings, hoping for ostriches and cheetah and perhaps wildebeest and jackals and all sorts of wonderful things like that. We might be lucky, we might not. It's quite cold here, and I was just saying to Brian this morning, Jamie kept reporting on the radio or via Louise in the final control that it was windy down here, and I kept saying, but are you sure it's windy down there? Because it was perfectly still on Juma. There's no... Whoop-whoop. Did you see it fly? Okay, Kirsten says you saw it. Right, we're taking it. That's number 35, I think, isn't it, Kirsten? 35, right?
35.
Yeah, 35. Maybe 36. Oh, 16. Damn.
Close.
No more than maybe 4 miles, if that. So I guess it must have to do with the height that we are and, of course, the big clearings that there are around here. Just in front of us. Of course, I've told myself that I wouldn't be competitive about this thing and that I didn't really care who won. And now I'm unable to be like that. Although, of course, it would be an honour to lose to Jamie Patterson. Brent was here, it would be a different story entirely. We'd be going at it hammer and tongs. Oh, Brian, there's not a lot out here at the moment. Not for the odd hoo-poo. Okay, we're now going to go towards Three in a Row Pan. See what we can spot there. Some of the last remaining water. Oh, quickly, go across to Jamie, she's got a great bird.
And that was a very rapid link. Thank you very much for that, James. It sounds as though James has been quite magnanimous. That is, of course, because he's winning at prison, so he has to say that. We'll see how things go when the tables have turned, naturally. Well, there you are, one of the prettiest of all of the bird species, and definitely one of the most striking, a black-headed oriole that will forever make me think of Sam, of course. Sam Chevalier was with us for a relatively short period of time, but he absolutely loved black-headed orioles. Well, there you go, that one was for Sam. Right, what's next? Just by the way, I left the elephants. They were moving off into some very dense vegetation. All of a sudden, they decided that it was time to go, leaving us free to go and search for other animals. A more to catch up with him, to draw level. And then, of course, it's a matter of seeing who wins. Okay, we're starting to get to the tricky stage with the birds. We've kind of ticked off most of the obvious ones. Here's a squirrel. James has already done a squirrel. The squirrel that supposedly nearly died of old age. Oh, Dave, I've got a cruel one for you. Dave is going to hate me after this. Where has it gone? Oh, goodness. Eight, a little bit to the right, the center of that bush. I think I just saw it fly away. There it is, there it is. You saw it? You all saw that? That was a chin spot battus, everybody. You definitely saw that, right? That definitely counts. Small little black and white bird called a chin spot battus that just flew off. And if you don't believe me, it's still there, but they don't really sit still. And we don't have the super zoom. The chin spot battus is still playing hard to get. However, James has elephants, and of course I'd just like to remind James that you can't count the same species twice.
But I can count the blacksmith lapwing. That 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, about 32, I think. I keep pulling out my microphone. Hang on one sec, Kirsten, I can't hear you, don't say anything. There we go. What else have we got here, Brian? Just hundreds of elephants. Dozens of them. Chris? Thank you for your question. I'm just looking for yellow-billed oxpeckers, perhaps, on these beefaloes. There are also beefaloes here, by the way. Chris? Chris, they erupt. There's a whole lot more ellies coming now. Chris, an elephant's tusks apparently erupt at 18 months for a cow, and at least for 18 months for a bull, and 2 years for a cow, I've read. I'm not sure that that's entirely true, though. Because I think I've seen older elephants than that with no tusks. So, well, that's what I've read once in a textbook. Now, this is interesting. See how they've turned to face this young bull coming in? Young bull's creating consternation. And it's not unlike when, I think, you know, if you're a sort of group of adults and young kids, and then a whole lot of everybody feels slightly uncomfortable, and they, you know, the parents will circle around their kids and kind of be protective of them. That's exactly what happened there. Three young bulls came in to have a drink, and the rest of the elephants thought, well, let's just see what's going on here and make sure that everyone is safe. Does blacksmith lapwing on a nest count as two or just one? I think two, maybe four. All right, let's go across to Jamie. She's got...
Covert monkey sitting in its usual spot around the Arethusa Lodge. So this is the Arethusa Dam troop, one that we've become quite familiar with. over the last few months. They're always around. And that, of course, is the back of Arethusa Lodge, just by the way, in case you're wondering about the various things. So we just wanted to show you that. A primate of a different description. We've got two primates now. Back to James and his elephants.
That's quite a cheeky thing. She got two primates. Anyway, I suppose she did. Ah, very nice that. It's a nice wilderness scene, don't you think there, Brian? Elephant playing with pipe. Super. So, yeah, I'm not sure that you can accurately say exactly when they erupt, to be honest. There, you can just see them. They're just coming out now. Just below the skin there. That is a ridiculous scene. That's one of the pipes, obviously, that supplies this little pan with water. Pleasant scene here at three in a row pan. Hello, Bridge. You're in London. What a nice question from you. You said, do elephants live longer than crocodiles? Bridge, they don't. Crocodiles, believe it or not, can live to over 100 years. Now, that is an astonishingly long time for any animal. But reptiles, you'll find, are quite long-lived. Tortoises, leopard tortoises, we think can probably live for up to that length of time. And crocodiles, certainly, at least 100 years. Elephants in this area, 55 to 60 years, probably just about the maximum. Alright, I think let's move on from here and head towards the clearings. The elephants have been remarkable over the last little while. They're a real joy to have around. Let me just call those in. There's the dove, but I think Jamie's had ring-necked dove. That's what that was. Unfortunately. And watch out. It's in that, it'll be in that marula tree somewhere. Let's just stop and have a quick look, everybody. If you can see the brown-headed parrot, whose most obvious feet, you've got it. You're a genius. Brown-headed parrot, everybody. Well done, Brian. Now, the brown-headed parrot, of course, has the most obvious feature being its bright green back. And you can hear it calling there, that very metallic call. I don't know if you know what I mean by the metallic call. It sounds like it's almost like a metal chisel hitting against an anvil, I guess. It's like a scrape. Alright, let's go across to Jamie. She's got a water buck, which she can't have, but she can have the other thing she's got. Dash it.
And the water buck might not count, but please don't tell him that, because he must be one of the most magnificent male water buck that I have ever seen. And then, of course, the giraffe behind him, which definitely does count. But before we go over to the giraffe, I just had to show you this waterbuck bull because he is truly spectacular. Look at the power in those shoulders and that dewlap that actually extends right down to his chest, giving him an enormous appearance. The symbol, of course, of the Sabi Sabi. Beautiful. Old boy. Deep ridged horns. Absolutely massive. I'd be guessing, but I'd say he must weigh 250, 300 kilograms, close to 600 odd pounds. He's huge and gorgeous. Right, well, our giraffe is slowly making a tentative approach, and oh no, we've changed direction. An almost tentative approach in towards us, having a quick nibble of the leaves. And I've totally lost track of what we're on in terms of totals, but that's okay. This is getting ridiculous. James continues to maintain a lead of 4 points. Oh, there goes our water buckball. Alright, let's go sneak up a little bit closer to our giraffe, see if we can't get a better view of her. So, James on 18, Jamie on 14, and yet the Arethusa Dam waits with bird species, where bird species abound. And hopefully that fish eagle that's calling in the distance is going to make an appearance. Alright, Oxpecker, are you yellow-billed or red-billed? Whoops. Okay, good. Quite an old giraffe cow. She's very dark in colour. Some, of course, are darker than others. She's also relatively large for a female giraffe. And they do have a tendency to darken a little bit with age. Alright. She's quite shy. She's not terribly good. Where there are jacanas, which I doubt James is going to find before me on Cheetah Plains. I'm relatively willing to bet he's not going to find on Cheetah Plains. I'm just thinking, something like a pangolin. Okay, just a pangolin. A pangolin is like the golden snitch in Harry Potter, and if you don't get that reference, basically if you catch the golden snitch, then you inevitably win the game. Now, the knowledge, I suppose, makes me a giant nerd, but also the fact that I think the pangolin should be like a giant snitch, no, a golden snitch, essentially titling us game winners of the competition. So, Dave, get on it, please. Dave being the only person so far who has spotted a pangolin, therefore has my utmost faith and trust in his ability to pull that off one more time. It is, of course, a huge ask of Dave. Here's another female giraffe over there, munching away on the guari bushes. They tend to be one of the few species that actually often eat the guari leaves themselves. Of course, lots of things feed off the guari berries, including human beings. Only the animals don't tend to feed off the leaves of the guari trees all that frequently. She's got quite wonky ossicones on the top of her head. Her horns slightly bent inwards, and that's probably as a result of a genetic defect rather than any kind of injury. It's those ossicones, rather than being called horns, in contrast to our waterbuck that we saw earlier, are made of solid bone, and a giraffe is born with them. Just so you know, I've been working on my giraffe silhouette hand puppetry, and you might be treated to that at some point in the next few days on a sunset safari. Haven't quite got it right though, and that of course is a reference to a sunset safari that occurred a few days ago, where we had a giraffe walking past in front of the sunset, and it looked so much like hand puppet, you'd never be able to unsee it. Okay, onwards from our giraffe and through to Arethusa Dam to see what awaits us. Of course, James has already ticked off hippopotamus. And speaking of James, let's go and see how he's doing.
We stopped here at the pan, everybody, but there's nothing unique going on. Otherwise, nothing going on there. A couple of doves, which we've already had. There's a crowned lapwing in this clearing, which we've already had. So now we're going to go down to the clearing just below here and see if we can't find maybe the Temminck courser. Scouring the clearings, I thought there might be some at least zebra or wildebeest here, but I think because it's a little windy and cold, you'll probably find they're all sitting in the thick... Hello, Kathy in North Carolina. You say, where are all the baboons? Now, well, that is a very good question. We heard some alarm calling this morning south of us, south inside Little Gowrie, which is the reserve to the south of us. Now, we now know that Karula's gone in there. We also heard a male lion calling in there, so maybe those baboons were seeing the lion or that leopard. But, you know, they're not that common around here. We don't have a huge number of, well, we don't have a permanent, oh, there's a Cape Glossy starling, sorry, on the ground there. Not Cape Glossy, it's a greater blue-eared glossy starling. Greater blue-eared glossy starling. So we don't see a great number of, right now, if I'm not mistaken, that's a greater blue-eared glossy. And in front of us, there's a Cape Glossy, if you can believe it. Look at that. I'm claiming both of those. Now, the reason you know the difference, no, it's not. That's a greater blue-eared as well, everybody. I'd love to claim it, but I'm not going to. I don't know. See if it calls. Brian, on the base of the termite mound there, there's a little brown bird. It's a rattling cisticola on the ground. Can you see it? Yeah, you got it. Well done, Brian. That is the advantage of this cheating with the... On you go. They've been definitely been coming through for... Oh dear, I feel like my lead is going to be eroded now. Let's go to Arethusa Dam with Jamie.
He just flew away.
Oh no. Fishy, oh, it's okay, he's coming towards us. He's coming closer, Dave. It's okay. There we go. We have found our African fish eagle, one of the most beautiful of all of the eagle species, and of course with the most iconic call. Angle grinding from elsewhere. Isn't he beautiful? We'll go and get a closer, we'll hopefully go and get a closer view of him in a moment. But we have arrived at Arethusa Dam, and I have to tell you, it's sort of bleak out here. We've got the standard Egyptian goose. There we go, we can tick that one off as well. Just one pair at the moment, settling down to bask in the afternoon light. Also, so that we can hear it clearly. Oh good, you did hear it clearly. The most distressing sight, I have to say, arriving at Arethusa Dam, is the poor hippo that is in the mud. I barely realized it was a hippo. I thought at first it was a rock, but that, I think, is the hippo, the hippopotamus. Shame. Life is really getting very tough for these poor animals. There's very little space left.
We've got that bird, Jamie.
We do have that bird, Dave. Unfortunately, that is a Cape Turtle dove. Very sad. And then, oh, we've got the catfish as well, which I don't think count as a bird species or a mammal species. But again, one of the sad sights of the treehouse and twin dams and the Vuyatela Dam and Buffalo's Hook Dam all dried up. We watched as the catfish slowly struggled. And I feel as though the poor guests of Arethusa, unless they go in and clear away those catfish, or clear away the catfish that actually die. Oh no, there's guinea fowl over there. Quickly, Dave, quickly, because Kirsty wants to send us to a Steenbok. There you go, guinea fowl, and then across to James.
There is a Steenbok, everybody. That is all. Okay, let's carry on. Very nice to have had guinea fowl for you and Jamie. Very unpleasant for us that you have had guinea fowl with Jamie. Not so, Brian. It's deeply unpleasant. Yes. I feel very hurt by it. Here are the great plains of Cheetah Plains, which miraculously are empty. Now we're still only four ahead. Every time we find something, Jamie finds two more things. It's dreadful. I feel a dreadful sense of pressure. Right, we're going to go and look in the next clearings and see if there aren't a herd. Ooh, no, those are starlings we've had before. I was hoping to find ostriches here. Nah, nothing. Oh, I can hear. We will see them. See them.
I can't.
Oh, no. Where are they, Brian? Scan everywhere. I think they're... Where? Where lookest thou? Temminck's Corsair? No, it's not. But it's not something we've seen before. It's a ground... Where is it? Where are you looking? There, okay, I got it now. Wait, everybody. It's a pipit. African pipit. Pipit. 22. Pipit. Now, we're going to find these magpie shrikes, which are calling. Yeah, there it is. See there, on the at the junction? Two Temminck's Coursers. Very nice, Brian. How beautiful are those birds, everybody? Look at their copper colours. I can see another pair across the road inside Mala Mala. That must be the Mala Mala pair of Temminck's Coursers. These are the Cheetah Plains Coursers. I think they're an astoundingly wonderful colour. I can hear many magpie shrikes calling. None of them... Oh, there we go. I've seen them, Brian. See that... You got it. Right, magpie shrike, everybody. Magpie shrike, well done. Many creatures we have got. Many creatures more we need. It's a lovely afternoon out here. There is, it's quite chilly breeze blowing, I must tell you. Those Temminck's Coursers are brilliant. Joey, you're in Australia and you want to know what the chance of seeing a sesame are on Cheetah Plains. Very small, Joey, I'd say almost negligible. Sesame, a bit like the roan and the sable and the hartebeest, not water dependent, need to be away from other water dependent grazers like impala and zebra. And so we just don't see a lot of them around here. You used to see quite a few, and you see them very nicely in Botswana, in the Okavango. You see them beautifully there. Now, Kathy, you're in Michigan, and you want to know what characteristics make a shrike a shrike. Kathy, the most notable thing about a shrike, I mean, I'm sure there are a number of genetic things that make a shrike, but the most characteristic thing is the tooth on the end of the bill. And all shrikes have got this tooth on the end of the bill. They're carnivorous, largely. They will eat, the grey-headed bush shrike will actually eat other birds. Most of them will eat insects and reptiles and that sort of thing. But they're all sort of carnivorous. And, you know, those are the most notable things about the shrikes. It's that hooked bill. That's the most obvious thing. Some of them might distinguish them most obviously from any other. I keep getting this microphone cable of mine stuck. It's going to result in my losing my temper very shortly, and then there'll be trouble. Let me plug myself back in. Right, I'm back in, Kirsten. Sorry about that. There must be a zebra here. I've seen thousands of zebras around here. That was quite a good return there, Brian. What are we on? 48 now. 49. Excellent. versus what? Is Jamie on 3 or something? It was 2. 49-2. he's still my heart. Now, we're coming into the next clearings here. And with any luck, there will be a great plethora of zebra knocking about with some wildebeest in tow and some ostrich. Ooh, And Carol, you say thanks to this competition, you've managed to add 3 birds to your bird list and you're up to 129. That's fantastic. I'm really impressed with that. Ooh, these clearings are rather devoid of life this afternoon. Ah, there is a Senegal lapwing. Senegal lapwing, everybody. And while you're looking at the Senegal lapwing, I shall scan the rest of the clearings. Beth, you want to know when the plovers were renamed to lapwings? Beth, they weren't all renamed to lapwings. It's the little ones. You know the plovers that you get on the coast? Those smaller birds. They're actually a different family. And so something like a three-banded plover. There we go. Three-banded plover is very closely related to those things. They're actually an entirely different family. And so that's why they were renamed. And that was some time back. I think it was around the year 2000. They're rather special, aren't they? They've all got such nice individual characteristics. So that's the Senegal lapwing. Don't see anything else going on in these clearings, but we'll move up ahead. And they've got a very similar strategy to the courser that we saw. They run along the ground and catch ants and termites and that sort of thing. Now they can fly very well, but they don't do a great deal of flying when they're looking for food. Come on, Brian, where are your ground hornbill friends?
I don't know.
I think they don't like the cold. This is in here, and then we'll turn probably back towards the west. Ah, there's a little bee eater. Have you got it there, Brian? Straight in front of us, 2 very small, 1 dead stick, 1 living one. That's it. Up a little? You got him? Ah, oh, well done. Little bee eater. Kirsten, you keep count. That's number 386 for us. Kathy, you... you want to send... Okay, Kirsten, just go with that again. I'm afraid the comms are not great. Terry with a T and Kathy with a C. To Patty with a P. Who's sending the shout-out? Terry is sending a shout out to Patty for introducing her to Safari Live. There we go, thank you, and I hope that you're having a wonderful 4th of July and perhaps you're watching together. Sorry about that, Terry and Patty, as opposed to Kerry and Kathy. So it's not that I'm going deaf, it's that we're at the far eastern end of Cheetah Plains and it's impossible to hear what Kirsten is saying. Elephants that we had earlier. Oh, there's a giraffe. Giraffe in front of us. We'll just try and ease up there. Stations, there was a herd of elephants moving south from Three in a Row Pan about 5 minutes ago. Also a small herd of buffalo there. There we've got a nice giraffe. Unfortunately, Jamie's already seen a giraffe. That doesn't make the giraffe any less important. Oh, look at the one lying down here, Brian. Definitely we get a point for lying down giraffe, don't you think?
At least
1 point. And Jamie had a female. We got lying down and female. Oh, we don't have a bull. That's a young bull. Half a point? not getting any joy from the final control today. Jennifer, you're looking at that giraffe. I think it is actually a young cow, with her little ossicones sticking out of the top of her head. And you're wondering if they're solid bone or not. They are absolutely solid bone. And we have a wonderful giraffe skull in the camp that has a nest. If I'm not mistaken, they differ from horns by not being attached at birth. So they're born with the ossicones at birth. They don't erupt from the skull like horns do. And then they fuse onto the skull from the base. And that's how they differ from horns. Antlers, of course, those things that deers have that fall off every year. And then the other kind of sort of a protuberance that comes off a head is something that the pronghorn antelope has. And the pronghorn antelope of North America, which I'm sure is also enjoying the 4th of July, is not in fact an antelope at all, but it does have a different kind of horn entirely, and I'm not entirely sure how that functions. But those are the four types of horns that you get on sort of herbivorous animals, and it does, it largely defines which family they fall. Let's move on from here. We'll go into the clearings of Ngoro. Well, not into them, we'll just look into them. We drive into them, we'll be arrested, Brian. And then we won't get any more birdies and things. I thought I saw something in this tree. It's very bright in my eyes. I didn't, it was a piece of the tree. How surprising. This is a particularly confiding giraffe cow. Look at her. She's standing so close to us. And I'm sure she's the mother of that other little one lying down. Mangled many times. And it's a Cambrium calinum, I think a variable bush willow. Look at her. That was all disdain, wouldn't you say, Brian? I'd say that was a look of absolute disdain. Very nice. Now, we know, of course, that giraffe don't love that sort of the tannin, able to eat on it forever. And because it's winter time, you'll find that the tannin levels of the trees have dropped, and so she'll be able to eat more of these than she would in the summer. And you very seldom see them eating Cambrium leaves in the summertime. I don't know if you can hear it there, but she's chewing, and you can hear the crunching of the leaves. Look at the light behind her too, it's just very beautiful. Wonderful. So nice. Here we go. Let's see what else we can find around the corner here. Dika, of course, still up for grabs, everyone. Wildebeest, zebra. What other antelope? Nyala, bushbuck, sable. Sharps, gresbok. Unlikely. Gemsbok. Pronghorn antelope. I don't think I'm trespassing now, am I? No. Ah. No, but I will be soon. Let me turn around here. That's the Kruger boundary there. Now, we don't want to go into the Kruger National Park because we thought we were going to be arrested on Kruger Park. It won't be very nice, Brian. I don't fancy an evening in the cells. Alrighty, so we're going to head off to the west. We'll go back past the pan there into the clearings and then probably make our way back sort of towards Juma in time for the fireside chat. where we will be talking about cubs. We've had some lovely cubs, so we'll have some George and Charlotte highlights. Valeria, you say that if Jamie wins, then I have to wear her beanie. I'm just waving at Ephraim there from Cheetah Plains. Okay, I'm happy to wear Jamie's beanie. If Jamie is happy for me to wear her ridiculous beanie with that enormous pom-pom on it, it's become quite a character, that thing, hasn't it? She says I can wear it. Oh, apparently it's not Jamie's beanie. It belongs to Kirsten Mack Smith. Therefore, it is inevitably a beautiful beanie. There are some, unfortunately, Natal Spurfowl, which we've seen already. Shall we call them Shelley's Franklins and get on with it? Or what?
Or Kirky
Franklin. Melanistic. Fossicking around in the elephant dung. They're looking for probably dung beetle larvae, which they're not going to really find. Termites they'll definitely find in there, and various other beetles and things that like to eat the dung. It's actually quite a nice sighting of a Natal Spurfowl. We'll just ease our way around them. You see they didn't run away, very confiding. They're habituated, Brian. Habituated Natal Spurfowl. Feel like we need to add to our tally almost immediately. Creatures. No. A tortoise would be nice. Oh, we can't count reptiles, can we? Well, I think the rule was birds and mammals only. Otherwise, Jamie will count those fish you saw. Can't have catfish in such a prestigious competition as this. The winter 4th of July mammal off. Now Jamie was just saying, I remember this morning she drove down through here and she was saying how this reminds me so very much of the sort of eastern coast of our country. Around Natal, KwaZulu-Natal, which is the eastern province of the country, and it's got this lovely rich red soil. That's where Kirsten's from. She's got red hair, you see. Maybe she's got lots of iron oxide in her. What do you think, Brian?
Most likely, hey.
It does, yes. It explains her rather sort of stern nature. We're going to be in a lot of trouble when we get home. Okay, we're popping out now into the clearings. And Chris Rogue, you wanted to give a shout out to the hyena group on Facebook. Yes, absolutely, we could do that with pleasure. So, here it is. A shout out to the hyena group on Facebook. It's called the Hyenas of Juma and Arethusa, and it's a wonderful group which keeps tabs on all the hyenas that we have here. And if you want to know about the hyenas, how to identify them, where they are, where they live, what the updates are, it's a great way to do it. And it's a brilliant group. So thank you, Chris, and thank you to all of you who maintain it. It's a great resource, it really is. Some blue wax bills. Did you see the blue wax bills? There we go, blue wax bill, everybody. Yes, please. I can't believe how excited I'm getting by seeing a blue wax bill. There we go. Bounce, bounce, bounce. Very nice. Oh, there's something else down there. That might be a cinnamon bun bird. You see on the little ones on the ground there? It may have moved. No, there's still two blue wax bills there. If you're wondering where Jamie is, everybody, a special sighting that will give her how many points, Brian?
Half.
Correct.
Yeah.
Maybe one. Now, I don't know where those other things went. Gracie, we may have just seen a cinnamon bun bird, but I'm not sure. That's a pity. Let's go a little bit forward. We might see them again. These grassy clearings are always a little bit productive. There we go. Now, keep an eye on the ground here, Brian. They would have landed somewhere around here. Cinnamon bun bird, where are you? Cinnamon bun bird, where are you? No, I see not the cinnamon bun bird. Sorry, Gracie. We'll keep... Hello, Viv. If I'm really struggling to hear the final control, but if I hear your question correctly, you want to know if there are ever records, any records of birds attacking humans in Africa. Is that correct? Affirmative. Right. Viv, yes, I mean, yes, a little bit. Like that crowned lapwing over there, if you get too close to their nests, they will attack you, or they'll fly over the top of your head and they'll dive bomb you and make you feel very uncomfortable. But they won't do any harm to a human being. The bird that you've got to watch out for is a human being. Well, I guess there are two. If you're a very small human being of about 2 or 3 years old, then the thing you need to watch out for is probably a crowned eagle. You've got kids playing in a garden, or kid on his own playing in a garden. It is quite possible the crowned eagle could take him or her, but it's unlikely. The bird you'd have to watch out for the most that could do physical damage to you would be an ostrich. An ostrich can do serious damage, and they have killed people from time to time. And what they do is they kick. I think much like an emu does, they kick, but they kick forward and they hack. Is that just a piece of tree? I think it is. Yeah, it's a bark, piece of bark. I thought it was maybe a kill hanging from the tree there. They kick forward, and when they kick forward, they can... Giraffe. Not a giraffe. Did I just say that? Did I really just say that? I did, didn't I? Yeah. No, not a giraffe, an ostrich. A giraffe will kick you, but with both legs, back and front, they can kick. But otherwise, you'd be safe from the birds here. No Alfred Hitchcock-esque scenes have played out here in Africa where swarms of nasty birds attack and kill people. And it played on a very nice phobia, that film, you know. People don't like that flapping wings around. And when I was a kid, certainly before I became a bush person, lying around in a confined space, the flapping wings. And I remember being deeply troubled by birds flying about in a room, if a bird came into the room, for example. Still scouring the land. I can hear some crombecks. It's the same as a bat. You know how if a bat flies onto your face? Well, that can be a very unpleasant experience, don't you think, Brian? I think I've spotted a herd of impala, Brian. I have. Way the other side of the clearing there. The hide nor hair of a zebra. And there were so many of them here recently. I think we're going to have to leave these clearings, Brian. Okay, let's go down to them and then we'll head further to the west. All right, let's go across to Jamie, get an update. She'll tell you a little bit about the surprise sighting that she's got to show you shortly, I hope.
Okay, guys, so we've sort of not counted ourselves out of this competition, but we have basically counted ourselves out of this competition, but that's because we have a really, really special surprise for you. What we're doing here, I know I'm quite quiet, I'm whispering because we're not actually that far away from where we need to be. It's been made a was. We found him as he found the surprise. though it's one vehicle only, we are waiting for Ryan to finish up enjoying his time with the animal that he tracked, and then we will be able to go in and have a look at whatever it is. I think he's about to call me in. Standing by. Absolutely no problem, Ryan. Take your time. We'll do a loop. Cool. Okay. So Ryan's just asking for an extra 10 minutes because things have changed in the sighting and it's become even more exciting. I'm not really keen on telling you what it is, but I think most of you will have guessed by now and guessed just as to where we are. Suffice to say, it's been a while since we last saw the surprise on foot. All right. Back over to James, who is probably by now streaks ahead in this competition, but that's okay, because we've got even better things planned.
Ah, crested barbet, everybody. I'm not sure if she told you what she was going to look at, but it does sound very exciting, and I'm rather jealous and excited for you. Anyway, I think you're going to enjoy it nevertheless. Right, there it is, the crested barbet. Very nice, very nice, very nice. Let's go back towards three in a row pan, and then we're going to head out of Cheetah Plains. You can see some... It's quite a few, Brian, don't you think? I think so. I'm very impressed with us. I think we're amazing. Especially as it's Jamie. You know, she's rather good at this sort of thing. Okay, we're going to move quite quickly down this way because we've covered this area before. Oh, wild beast. There it is. Yes. Out to all the chatters on YouTube, Ustream, and what's the other one? Nat Geo Wild, Ustream, and YouTube. Thank you to all of you for the time that you give us. It really is much appreciated, and without you, of course, this would just be two idiots driving around the bush looking at animals. It's much more fun with a whole lot of people to share it with us from all over the world, and on today, of course, in America, the Philippines, and Rwanda. He's quite a splendid fellow. On his own. And unusual that he hasn't found a herd of impala to lurk around with. And see that lovely brindled colour around. That's very nice. And look at him. That's a brilliant picture. So he's obviously eating grass. That's pretty clear. But he's also eating relatively short grass. And apparently they'll tell you that the zebra eats slightly longer grass than them. And if you watch a warthog feed, I don't know how many of you watched the last time we super zoomed a warthog snout feeding. They scuffle under just lower down than where that wildebeest is eating. And you can see he's getting a little bit of the stolons, that's the underground. This is fantastic. Hey, this is actually a very, very nice area for them to be grazing. And his nose twitching away there. And these guys will maintain, they'll maintain a lawn. And you can see, I mean, this kind of grass cannot be that nutritious. And that's fine for a little bit, but after a while, especially as the dry season progresses, it'll be more and more difficult to maintain condition. Does that wildebeest have one eye? No, there it is. There's the eye. Phew. We don't often get to spend time like this with a wildebeest, I've got to tell you. It's a very special little sighting. Not quite as special as the one that Jamie's taking you to, but almost. Don't you think, Brian? Yeah, I mean, look at that. That's spectacular. I wonder if we were to open the shot
on or open come live with a picture like that if you'd be able to identify what animal it was. In the main. This is so cool. And you can see the stripes very clearly there. We don't tend to think of them as being striped animals, but they are. We think it helps break up the outline, and maybe not quite as black and white as the zebra, but definitely covered in stripes. There's no birds calling at all. I think that's got to do with the cold, I would say. I might be wrong, but I think that's what it is. What do you think, Brian?
I think so too. Mm-hmm.
All right, everyone, let's move on from here. Wonderful wildebeest. Now, Kitra in India, you want to know about the wildebeest migration. Sorry, I'm struggling to hear the names, as you can see, as Kerry and Kathy will attest to. Chitra, no migration in the Kruger, no. Well, there used to be, apparently, between the permanent water sources of, say, the Sand River or the Sabi River, and then during summer they'd migrate up to the perennial rivers like the Timbavati. Now, there are two reasons I don't do that anymore. One is the provision of artificial water, so you've seen those pans. We were at those water holes today, and so that means they don't have to move from one game reserve to the other. And then also the drying up of some of the perennial rivers, or at least of the annual rivers. So if you go up to an area like the Timbavati, there's a massive, massive riverbed there with a river that only flows probably once and keep permanent pools just about all the time. And that doesn't happen anymore. And that means that there's no point in this great migration going up there because there isn't any real water. But yes, absolutely, there used to be a migration, but humans placing water everywhere has put paid to that wonderful migration. And the number of wildebeest. Wildebeest like to migrate, and there are substantially fewer wildebeest in this area than there were, say, 30 years ago. Well, I thought I saw something there, but I think it was just the light flashing through that broken down piece of bark. Larry, you say you were watching that unbelievable BBC show, The Hunt, and you were watching the wildebeest taken out by those wild dogs. It is an astonishing, astonishing sequence, that. And the technicality, I found watching the behind the scenes thing afterwards even almost as fascinating as watching those wild dogs hunting. But they have managed again to put together a unique sort of sequence on how things happen in the wild. A really brilliant, brilliant scene. And if you haven't seen it, everyone, do yourselves a favor and go and hear David Attenborough narrate you through an unbelievable wild dog sighting. I think it was taken in Botswana, if I'm not mistaken, with some astonishing equipment, but really spectacular stuff. And eye level is just, moving at eye level is so unusual because, you know, we have our human perspective. And to get right down on the ground and watch how an animal moves is, I think it was just brilliant. They got a wonderful tiger hunt as well. And you should, if you haven't, there's a very, very large elephant. We know this guy. He's that tuskless bull, enormous tuskless bull. And that's not totally uncommon. It's not usual, but it's not that common either. Unfortunately, every time I push Rusty's clutch in, it goes like you pulling a tooth out without an anesthetic. I'm sure it hurts horribly, and there's a very long nerve inside the tusk, but this animal hasn't broken his tusks, I don't think. I think that he was born without them, and that does happen every so often with these elephants. They're born without tusks. You've got to be a little bit wary of them. They can sometimes, or so I'm told, tend to be slightly more aggressive because they've been bullied, but I've never seen that, and this guy doesn't seem to be at all. And you can see how he's enormous. I mean, he's a fully grown bull, and he's got no tusks at all. We'll just stop here and let him come into the southern black tit. Isn't that nice? Very strange to see a big behemoth-like bull without any tusks. Very odd indeed. You can see where the tusks would have erupted, but they ain't there no more. Don't you think, Brian?
No.
A bit mournful. Let's follow him down to the water. We'll follow him at a distance. I think he's in must. I can't smell anything. Oh, there's another big bull. This waterhole is Elephant Central. We'll just drive very slowly behind him and enjoy him. Let's see another one there. He's not in a rush. All right, everybody, Jamie's got a surprise for you, and I don't think she can be there very long. So let's go straight across to her now.
This is definitely a sighting that we've been looking forward to having. It's Shadow, guys. Shadow, and somewhere hidden in here is Shadow's cub as well. She's got a monkey kill that she's currently feeding on, crunching away. I don't know where the cub is, so I'm speaking very... Oh no, that's a log. Well, so we're absolutely really privileged to be here and so lucky that Ryan called us in when he did. As James mentioned, we can't be here for too long. For a couple of reasons, the main one being that it is starting to get dark and there are a couple of other vehicles that would very much like to come and see the sighting. So we've just got to hope that Shadow's little one decides to show itself. There we go, we've got it. Well spotted, Dave. Oh my goodness. It's okay, little one. Hi. Stalking Mum already. And so beautifully relaxed. Oh, this is so incredible. Shadow's little 4-month-old female cub. How lucky are we? Hi. Aren't you gorgeous? This is absolutely... So for those of you who are joining us for the first time, you're watching a 4-month-old leopard cub live from the African bush. It really doesn't get better than this. Look how relaxed it is. Can I have some too, Mum? Absolutely fantastic. This is Karula's daughter, Shadow, and Karula's granddaughter. So much smaller and fluffier than Karula's cubs are now. Sneaking around towards Mum. The little cub is finding other ways of amusing itself, including sniffing the apple leaf. Our shadow, when she first had these cubs, decided to den them on a main road. And what that meant was... Oh! You've got to know which branches will bear your weight and which ones won't, I guess. Little Phlegm and Grimace. I didn't even know that they're Phlegm and Grimace this young. How amazing is that? At the edge of that branch and then being flung upwards like a spring. What's there? What smells so nice? Hmm? Something smells very interesting on this apple leaf. And James, the closet royalist, apparently has been calling this little cub Zara. This is absolutely magical. In this afternoon light. Oh, flop. Flop. For a moment. Now, this monkey won't last very long, and unfortunately neither will this sighting for us. We will have to leave very, very soon. But this has been such a marvelous moment. But we can't deny other people the opportunity to view this sighting in this glorious, dappled afternoon light. And hello to safari lover Elaine, while we watch one of our newest additions to a different genus to our domestic cats and the smaller cats. They are given a different terminology. They're called cubs rather than kittens, because they're part of the Panthera family. I think Shadow's about to cough up a hairball. She's making the most peculiar burping sounds. She might have eaten a bit too fast. Oh, wow. Wow, wow, wow. I'm so thrilled. It was worth losing the competition just for this. And Dean, in Nelspruit, you were wondering, as Shadow provides us with a few burps, what the chances are of Shadow and Karula's cubs having the same father. Coming to get a little bit of food. Here we go. She only ate half of it. She left the rest for her cub. And the answer is very, very high. They both mated with Tingana. And we think that Karula also mated with Anderson. We know that Shadow definitely did. There's a very high percentage chance that the cubs have the same dad. Of course, leopards not bound by the conventions of the traditional family. Guys, we do have to go. We can't hog the sighting. It's just one of those things that's been found at sunset. I have to call in the next person. Let me just get onto the Game Drive channel, find out where they were. Station on first standby for Shadow and Bontuan. What's your position? Okay, copy. If you want to start making your way, I'll pull out when you get here. Okay, so we've got about 2 minutes or so before we have to... I know I've put us in an awkward place, but I don't want to scare the little cub away. I think we're okay, though. I think this little cub is incredibly relaxed around vehicles, so let's try to get a nice view before we have to pull out. Okay, we're just going to switch on. And let the engine run a little bit. Okay. Cub hasn't stopped feeding. Shadow hasn't stopped grooming. But even if it's not the best view in the world, we'll settle for it. There's Shadow, the marvelous mother. Well done, girl. Caught a monkey. Clever, clever girl. Giving herself a jolly good room. Groom. Just goes to show, guys, the sacrifice that leopard mothers make for their cubs. She left most of that kill, and I think she was hungry, judging by the speed at which she ate it. She left most of that kill for the little one, who unfortunately has dragged it into a very awkward position. I can just see some movements behind the leaves. Leopards are pretty much the only thing that are capable or agile enough to catch a very sharp-eyed and agile monkey. Oh, little cub, come on, one last view. Sorry. One last, there we go, thank you. And while our little cub feasts on mom's monkey, Canada Keith, how common is a monkey kill for a leopard? Relatively. I couldn't give you an exact percentage. If I had to guess what percentage of its diet it makes up, maybe between 10 to 15%, maybe a little bit less. It's something we can double check what James thinks on the fireside chat while I gloat about the cub and he gloats about his victory in our ranger race. Catch a monkey. Oh! Amazing. So tiny and already weaned. But little teeth, not always that strong, or at least the jaw muscles not quite strong enough to pull away the meat, and a bit of shaking is what's necessary. Kelly in Florida, you're right, it might not be a pangolin. Oh, look at that. Isn't that incredible? I think we deserve a lot of points for this, actually. And he made that point when he left the sighting. He asked to just remind me that the six ones that will be delivered to him later will be culled upon arrival. And some of you will understand exactly what I'm talking about when I say that. We do owe Ryan big time for the sighting. And a little bit of luck as well. I can't really claim any credit for this. This is incredible. Absolutely incredible. A bit macabre. But incredible nonetheless. Poor little leopard teeth. Yes, little cub. I hear the sound of the vehicle too. On its way. Oh, look at that. There's going to be a smile on my face for the rest of the day. Possibly the rest of the week. Very gruesome. Decidedly gruesome. Oh. Standing by. Last look at the cub. Absolutely extraordinary. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you, Shadow. Oh, look at that. Oh, you naughty little thing. Okay, guys, we have to go. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. How incredible was that? Hissing at mom. Little brat. Goodness gracious. Mom provides dinner and then gets hissed at by cub. absolutely incredible. Okay. Let us make... Oh. Wow. While we shuffle around here, it seems it's an afternoon full of babies. Back over to James.
This ridiculous creature in front of us. Hello. Yes, you're so big and brave. Look at him. He's got his face in the mud. I can't even see him. Sorry, and the mother is just next to us. She doesn't care less. She thinks he's being ridiculous as we do. This is just too wonderful for words. I'm touching the car, you know. He's too close for my... Sorry, we're going to have to move. We just had to turn the car off on, everybody, because there is a... The mother got a little bit irritated. How's the audio now, Kirsten? Just suckling now, look at that. She wasn't irritated at all with us. She just obviously thought the baby was getting too close. She's very close now. She's only about 3 feet from us. No. Come on, little fellow. You stay with your mum. Flow carefully. And she wasn't in the slightest bit worried about us. Look at it suckling there. It's an unbelievable picture. She's so lovely, look at her. She's got such a calm about her face, but that'll get very changed completely if she decides that we're a threat to her little baby. And the baby turned us into a bit of a threat there. I don't think it was us at all. Isn't she lovely? Unbelievable sighting. Now my plan, everybody, was to take you to some mating lions. And I'm not sure that we're going to make it in time for the fireside chat, because this is too special for words. So close to us. I find myself leaning towards the left of where I'm sitting because she is so very close. She's now kind of dropping off. That is an incredible picture, people. We dug some dirt. She's too close for me to take a picture with my camera. I'm having to use my phone. Which is just amazing. She's only 3 feet from the car. Hey, don't be silly. Stay there. Well, don't laugh at it, you're encouraging it. This is unbelievable. That shadow you can see, it's just too wonderful.
Look at her trunk there, Brian. You can see my shadow on it. Go on then. You've been tremendously kind to us. Thank you very much. No, no, you being silly. That's it. Stay with your mum. That is just... Thank you. No, no, don't worry. We're not in any shape, way or form of danger to you, I promise. Off you go. Ah, wow. I think we're going to skip those lines because we're going to have to go to our fireside chat. Just remember the fireside chat, everybody. Look at that. Sun is going to be on our normal stream. So I know many of you struggled with that Facebook streaming thing that we tried to do, and we will do that again once we've got decent bandwidth to do it with. Get that in there. Gee whiz. So what happened there, I think, everyone, was she was completely relaxed with us. She didn't even look around. That little thing came too close. I mean, that little thing was half a foot from the car when she turned and she thought, no, 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 that's too much. And she came to within what, Brian? I mean, she came to within sort of, and she didn't kind of, she wasn't angry. She was just kind of saying, whoa, what's going on here? I don't understand. Let's just, let's everybody back off from each other. And the little one did. And then she was fine. You saw her nearly drop off there. She nearly fell asleep. Her eyes went shut and that little thing was suckling. I don't know that we've ever had a shot like that before. Yes, you're going to... Hey! Michael, you want to know how much milk a little fellow like this is going to drink a day? I actually don't know, Michael. That's a really good question. I really couldn't tell you. I'm going to guess at around probably... this is a real guess. I'm going to say 5 to 10 liters a day. Now, I mean, that's ridiculous because it's, you know, it's 100% different from each other. But there she is. The little one is now standing 3 feet from us. If she takes any, if she comes any closer towards us, I'm just going to move off because we're going to escalate a situation that doesn't need to be escalated. He's just playing. Yes, but way big and strong. But you also mustn't learn to do this, of course. Look at him. Ah, she's... she's fine. She's not even looking at us, you know. He's tempted to touch him. I don't know what that face planting thing is that they do every so often. I've only ever seen young ones do it. Where they come close up and then they don't know what to do. You don't move away, and so they plant their faces into the dirt, which is bizarre. He's so cool. Every time he comes, he comes. Hiding behind a bush. All right, everyone, we're going to have to leave, I'm afraid. We're going to have to move from here. And I'm going to have to take a slightly shorter. Maybe, Kirsty, if you can just tell her those lines are on hippo pools, if she's anywhere close by, she might be able to get them. One, sorry, quickly before you go, have you gone? Sleeping. You see the one sleeping on the floor here? Look, there we go. One little elephant snoozing, fast asleep on the floor, exhausted by the day. Completely exhausted. Isn't that awesome? All right.
We are sitting and watching the sun go down from Impala Plains. I'm just marveling at what a wonderful day it is to be out in the African bush. I am, of course, biased because we've just come from a sighting of a leopard cub. Truly marvelous. Isn't that absolutely beautiful? And then the imposing silhouette of the Drakensberg Mountains, running for all the way from the setting sun and continuing south. And continuing south, about a woo woo! I hear hyenas. Should we go find them?
Yeah.
Yep, I think so. We may not have won the competition, Dave, but we sure as heck gonna go out with a bang. Let's go find these hyenas. Unfortunately, guys, we are too far to get to those lions. Just in terms of distance and then having to film myself, we won't be able to get there in time and then back across to Fireside Chat. Both Dave and Chelsea look relieved that that was my decision. I don't really think they fancy walking home, battered and bruised, having been launched off due to a bump. Right, hyena, I hear you. They're somewhere, it actually sounds like they're somewhere close to that buff. Been talking about this and we got caught in a situation where we had to choose a sighting. We had to choose the mating lions and the female that was with them, or we had to go back to the Nkuhuma, the other two Nkuhumas with their buffalo kill. And we stayed with the mating lions, but apparently when the guys went back to the buffalo kill, it had been snapped, but the hyenas dragged it onto Simbambili. Which means that they do have, our clan does have a den site on Simbambili, or most likely they have a den site on Simbambili. Oh, Kirsty, sorry, I turned you right up there. My right ear. There we go. That's a little bit more reasonable. But yes, it looks as though they've got a den somewhere on Simbambili. So Gwen, the new hyena mother, she appears to be keeping herself relatively safe. I think the rest of them have moved across towards Simbambili, which means that we only unfortunately ever catch fleeting glimpses of them every now and again when they come back onto Juma. And it's interesting that they chose to move that far west, particularly considering. So it's interesting that our hyenas chose to move in that general direction. All right, and keep our eyes peeled. It sounded like the hyena was calling from somewhere here. Of course, the difficulty being that hyenas don't tend to sit still as night falls, especially if they're busy territorially whooping. They often move about a lot. I meant to do this earlier, but I got distracted by the glorious nature of the sunset, but my microphone, which lives under my hat. Oh, jackal! Never mind. I'll readjust while we look at the jackal. Hello, guys. Oh, it's our side-striped jackal pair. Absolutely awesome. There's one there, and there's one here. Well, he's much bigger than the female, much stockier. Side-striped jackals. Oh, see if we can't see them from here. I think they're going to. Oh, they're going to go behind that tree. I see them. Thank you, Dave. There we go. Well done. Well spotted, Dave. Absolutely marvelous. So it seems as though our side-striped jackal pair have established themselves on Impala Plains and Sandy Patch Road. Their little tear in the not too distant future, the possibility of the pitter-patter of little jackal pup paws. Let's try for one last view. While we do, over to James, who's added another species to his list.
There we go, everybody. We've got